Good morning. Welcome to the Methodist Church. If you are visiting, please let us know by texting the word visit to 559-657-6848. And be sure to fill out the digital connection card so that we have a name with the number. If it's not your first time, then please text the word here to that same number, 559-657-6848. I appreciate all of those who participate in Text in Church. Children of all ages are always welcome in worship. Kiddos ages 3 years through sixth grade who would like to attend Sunday school during the sermon time can meet near the north doors located on my right, that-a-way, after the first praise song. For those with toddlers and infants, our nursery is available for your convenience. Both Sunday school and nursery are now located in this building in rooms 21 and 22. Just go out the north doors, make a left, you can't miss it. Our annual family Christmas program, A Christmas Suite, will be held on Sunday, December 17th at 6 p.m. Mark your calendars and invite your friends and family to join you on December 17th. If you would like to participate by baking or purchasing some delicious treats for a dessert buffet, please call the church office. We have three giving opportunities we'd like to share with you today. Our toy drive for the Gift of Joy service. Today's the last day to donate your new unwrapped toys to be distributed in Tipton and Visalia on December 17th. Amada will be in the lobby today to help you with toy ideas and ages of children who have registered. Our Gifts of Love, helping families provide Christmas gifts for children. This is our traditional Christmas gifting program. We have just 9 children left to serve. Choose a child or two, 3 or more. Provide wrapped Christmas gifts that parents will pick up and surprise their children on Christmas morning. Children's names, ages, and wish lists are available, and a couple of the men from the men's ministry whom I partner with them. They started this beautiful ministry. They will be available between services, and I'll be back there to answer any questions or help you pick a child. Our Christmas memorial giving. You can donate in honor or memory of loved ones. The deadline to be listed in our Christmas Eve bulletin is December 19th. Forms are available at the welcome desk and next to some of the offering plates. You can also call Joanna in the church office. Our Christmas Eve services this year are on Sunday. So we will have 2 family worship experiences. We will gather together here at 9:15 for a traditional service of lessons and carols, or at 5 p.m. for our Christmas Eve candlelight service. Invite your family, friends, and neighbors to join you and attend one or both for a very Merry Christmas. Our Pound of Love drive-through food distribution and neighborhood market will be held this Wednesday, December 13th from 8:30 to noon. You can serve for an hour, 2 or more. This is a community service event and all are welcome to participate by serving or to come and get some food. And today the altar flowers are presented by Dave and Charlene Watkins in memory of their parents and son, Alexander. Thank you, Dave and Charlene. All right, it's my favorite Sunday of the month, and that's because it is Drop in the Bucket Sunday. You can tell because there's little silver buckets all around the sanctuary. This is a program for those who may be visiting or unfamiliar with our Drop in the Bucket program. This is a ministry that we just ask that you drop your loose coins or small bills into the buckets before you leave the sanctuary today. Then we gather those offerings together to reach out into our community to someone who is just needing a little bit of help and who is struggling to make ends meet. Drop-in-the-Bucket partners with area agencies and organizations to meet the needs of those struggling families in and around Visalia. In the month of November, Drop-in-the-Bucket worked with Tulare County Community Coordination Team and Visalia Adult Integrated Clinic to help 6 individuals and their families. For a young woman recovering from major health issues that caused her to lose her car and home, a bus pass to be able to look for employment was an answer to prayer. The therapist and social workers at Visalia Adult Integrated Clinic work with several recovery centers in the area. As their clients work on making healthier choices, they often have significant weight losses. Clothing no longer fits, and basic garments are needed. Drop-in-the-Bucket provided gift cards for 4 individuals to make those necessary purchases. For a young woman longing to be independent and self-sufficient, the fees to renew her driver's license felt like an overwhelming barrier. Drop-in-the-Bucket removed the barrier by paying the reissuance fees to the DMV. Drop-in-the-Bucket is just one way the Methodist Church is loving our community for Christ. We choose to make a difference in the lives of others because Christ has made such a big difference in ours. You can help by dropping your loose change or small bills in one of the buckets as you leave today. For those joining us online, please consider adding a small amount to your giving and designate it to Drop-in-the-Bucket. We will make sure the funds are combined to make big differences in someone's life. Together, we are loving our community for Christ. And now I would like to invite Sharon and
here,
Pastor
here
Steve.
Here we are.
There they are.
Just give us that mic.
There you go. Okay, this morning we are lighting the second Advent candle. The angel sang a message of joy. She gave birth to her firstborn son. She wrapped him snugly in strips of cloth and laid him in a manger because there was no lodging available to them. That night, there was a shepherd staying in the fields nearby, guarding their flocks of sheep. Suddenly, the angel of the Lord appeared among them, and the radiance of the Lord's glory surrounded them. They were terrified, but the angel reassured them. "Don't be afraid," he said. "I bring you good tidings that will bring great joy to all people. The Savior, yes, the Messiah, the Lord, has been born today in Bethlehem, the city of David, and you will recognize him by the sign. You will find a baby wrapped snugly in strips of cloth, lying in a manger." Suddenly, the angel was joined by a vast host of others, the armies of heaven praising God and saying, "Glory to God in the highest, and peace on earth to those with whom God is pleased." When the angel had returned to heaven, the shepherds said to each other, "Let's go to Bethlehem. Let's see this thing that has happened, which the Lord has told us about."
Amen. Thank you.
Thank you, Sharon. If you will rise for the reading of Scripture this morning, I will be reading from Luke chapter 2, verses 10 and 11. And the angel said to them, "Fear not, for behold, I bring you good news of great joy that will be for all the people. For unto you is born this day in the city of David a Savior, who is Christ the Lord." May the Lord add blessing to the reading of his word. And now, if you will bow your heads and join your hearts with me in prayer. O holy and patient and loving God, in this season of grace-filled longing, we await the coming of your Son and our Savior. It is difficult for us to remember that this is a holy time. There are many distractions, commitments seem to pile up, and expectations are high. In the midst of our busy world, our busy lives, We need your help to remind us of what is important and necessary. While many of those things that we do not need will come in to us in packages gleaming and bright, the one gift that will last comes from you alone. As we grow in our awareness of your love, bless us, bless our families, and bless our friends and the community that we share. Increase in us a growing urgency to celebrate the birth of your Son. We pray together the way he taught us, our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name, thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. And now, if you will stay standing as you are able, and join your voices with Alejandra and the band as we sing to our Savior and Lord Jesus.
God rescue Mary, gentlemen, let nothing you dismay. For Jesus Christ, our Savior, was born on Christmas Day to save us all from Satan's power when we were gone astray. Oh, tidings of comfort and joy, comfort and joy. Oh, tidings of comfort and joy. From God our Heavenly Father, a blessed angel came, unto certain shepherds brought tidings of the same, how that in Bethlehem was born the Son of God by name. Oh, tidings of comfort and joy, comfort and joy. Oh, tidings of comfort and joy. Comfort and joy. Oh, tidings of comfort and joy. Thank you. is not a feeling. Come on, don't stop believing. Alleluia, alleluia.
Amen. Thank you. Please be seated. So I have always wanted to entitle something that the church did, Lose 20 Pounds Fast, and I finally found a way. So in January, we'll start a sermon series through the Torah, the first five books of the Bible, and we're going to advertise it with flyers around town that say, Lose 20 to 30 pounds fast, and then the byline will say, Just kidding, right? We're dealing with reality. We'll be looking at many of the children's stories of the Bible in an adult way. I just wanted to get that off my chest because it feels great finally to have accomplished another goal. Today is the second Sunday in Advent, and this year the scripture reading called for is about John the Baptist. I'm going to give you some context and some background before we look at the scripture, hoping that that will open the scripture up for you. So let's start this way. One of the things we're aware of, but we don't always concentrate on, is that during the historical time of Jesus and John the Baptist, the Jewish communities, Israel, was very much like the modern world in that they were divided into several different sects, several different ways of understanding the Torah, the Old Testament, and several different ways of thinking that they were the best chosen people as opposed to the other ones. The easy reference is just think about the reality that we live in. So we live in a world where there are Catholic, Roman Catholic people, and there are Eastern Orthodox people, two big branches of Christianity. In the U.S., we deal mostly with Lutherans, and we have a variety of flavor of Lutherans. We have fun Lutherans. We have very, very serious, unhappy Lutherans, and we have Lutherans that kind of bounce back and forth. We have Calvinists, and again, several flavors of Calvinism, right? The absolutely convinced they're right and everybody else is wrong Calvinists, the shrug and it's good for me if it's not good for you type of Calvinists. We have Mormons. I don't know if there's several different types. I do know there are two main branches of Mormons in the modern world. We have Seventh-day Adventists. We have woke Christians. We have fundamentalists. They, we hope, balance each other out. We have charismatic Christians. And, of course, we have the one true religion. That would be the worship of Jesus. There's nothing wrong with the fact that there are so many different ways to pursue a relationship with Jesus, but that really doesn't mean that everything is right about that either. It's interesting to me that the divisions that are still a part of our trying to follow God, trying to be within His will, the divisions happen for pretty much the same set of reasons. So what happens is that while we are on the walk of faith, trying to follow, in our age, Christ, there are lots of shiny objects and lots of other things that catch our attention, and those things can slow our walk down or completely cause us to be off of the path. And again, that's happened for as long as people have been following God. So I'm going to go through the groups of folks in the ancient world in the time of Jesus, and you can do the equivalency as I go. I might, for fun and amusement, throw in a couple modern things, but I just want to break down the groups that were a part of religious life in the time of John and Jesus. So first, there were the Pharisees. Raise your hand if you've ever heard of them. Pharisees? Yeah. Okay. Pharisees, in essence, believed this. They thought that God was going to send the promised deliverer and make Israel a great empire, or the head of a great empire, if only other people would stop their stinking sin. And so they devoted themselves in great detail to following the law in every which way that they could think of, which isn't so much fun. If you've tried to follow the law in some kind of great detail, you know, it can wear on you. So to lighten things up a little bit, what the Pharisees did was they spent half their time trying to follow the law and the other half the time having meetings where they assured themselves that they were the righteous ones because they were keeping the law. And the trouble and the reason Israel was in bad times and the reason God hadn't finished his promise was because of other people. If you haven't tried that before, believing that other people are the problem, it's a blast. It makes you feel so much better. The difficulty, of course, is that it sets you on a course to change the other people, and mostly what you'll discover is no matter how right you are, if you tell other people the problem is them and you want them to change, they will do just the opposite. So they had Pharisees who were keepers of the law and were determined to use whatever power they could to make other people keep the law. If you want a snapshot of that from Scripture, that would be Saul later in the New Testament hunting down Christians who definitely in his mind weren't keeping the law and making sure that they were executed. Pharisees. Pharisee is an ancient word meaning fun. There were Sadducees. And I'll be honest with you, I dislike this group more than any other both in the modern world and in the ancient world. So the Sadducees were the political and social elite of Jewish society. The upper echelons of the priesthood of the temple, all Sadducees. You had to have that power, that money, and that kind of name brand recognition. They held also most of the political offices. It weirds Americans out because the church and the state are separated somewhat. But in ancient Israel, they weren't. They were one and the same. So most of the political offices that were worth having, that carried some power and prestige, were handled by Sadducees. And the Sadducees' belief system is, in my humble opinion, evil. They're more noteworthy for what they don't believe in than what they do believe in. And what they didn't believe in, they didn't believe in heaven or hell, or any kind of consequence after physical death. They certainly didn't believe in resurrection. They did not believe in eternal life. Doesn't that seem to you to be pretty much the thrust of all the religious folks, that we believe in eternal life or thing consequences to? They didn't believe in any of that. And so what they believed in, for lack of a better word, was a heavy dose of predestination. So Sadducees said to themselves, you know what? We were born into this power structure and this wealth because it ran through families, and we don't think anything happens after you die. And so our religious task, the way we serve God, is we keep the riffraff out of our movement. You got it? You couldn't like fill out a form and become a Sadducee. You were born one. And if you were a Sadducee and somebody started to mess with you or in other ways cause trouble, the Sadducees' point of view was that God wanted them to be the elite and to be the rulers, and so they had a vested interest in shutting down anybody who might be popular or might cause trouble or might even question how it is they have all the power that they have. And they did that very successfully because the average citizen of Israel understood about the Sadducees that they sold out to Rome a long time ago. And so in combination with Roman power and their authority, they made sure nobody invaded their territory or got any of the good stuff they had. They were born into privilege, and their goal was to keep privilege, and they believed they should be able to do anything they want in order for that to happen. Anybody in love with the Sadducees? Yeah, right. So we give the Pharisees most of the bad press because they make the headlines in Scripture more than Sadducees. But the Sadducees, that's a scary lot, right? They're religious people who effectively believe everything is happens in the flesh, and they furthermore believe that God wanted them to keep everything for themselves and let the riffraff fend for themselves. It's no wonder that Jesus saved some special criticism for the Sadducees. So you got the Pharisees running around keeping the law and wishing that you would do the doggone same thing. You got the Sadducees who can't even see you unless you're a troublemaker, and then they can see you clearly. There were zealots. Let me give you a different word for that. Assassins. a long history of Israel, going clear back to the Old Testament. There are a movement of what we would call zealots, what they did call zealots. So zealots could be your next door neighbor, could be your brother or your father. They met in clandestine meetings, and they carried out a systematic assassination of Roman authorities and occasionally of Jewish people who they thought had gone over to the other side. And they were dialed into the belief that what had to happen was they needed to spark a war with Rome. And their fundamental belief was if they did that and they gained a couple of victories at first, that because the people of God were finally killing the enemies of God, that then God would almost have to unleash his angel armies, and together they would overthrow Rome, and then Israel would be the premier amongst the nations. Really scary people, really serious people, and in truth, they are the picture of the delusion that carried the day in Jesus' time, that somehow an action or something that was thought or said could trigger and force God into doing for the people of Israel what they most wanted. There were Essenes. And the Essenes are one of my favorite groups because I'm from a place that would be the kind of place that the Essenes would live. I'm from nowhere, out in the middle of nowhere, right? You're not from Wyoming, so I'll just tell you how it goes. Here, when you say, well, I'm going to go to Tulare, somebody will give you that destination in miles or maybe in about how long it usually takes, right? And if you're not from here, you might even be a little confused whether you're in Visalia or Tulare, although that's silly because everybody knows Visalia is brighter and shinier. And but it's confusing. Like when you're in L.A., when are you ever really in L.A.? You don't actually know, do you? Okay. In Wyoming, you are either in Casper or Cheyenne or Lander, or you're not. No one's ever been in Casper and said, I wonder if I'm in Casper, because there's nothing else within 100 miles of Casper, right? And there's nothing else within 100 miles of Casper because too many people visit during the winter and discover the horrible truth about living in Wyoming. You don't want to. So Wyoming is a collection of interesting people. And if you go there, let's say, and wander around and you see a sign that says, no trespassing, do you know what you should do? You should not trespass. Because chances are the people behind the no trespassing sign really, really meant it. And it's offensive to them if you're anywhere on their land and they'll come talk to you with a gun on their hip or in their hand. So I come from an oddball place that nobody in their right mind really wants to be in. The Essenes were a bunch of oddballs. They were strange people. Here's their conception. They thought, well, God's going to come and set everything up the way we want it, right? The world will bend to our desire. But what we have to do is get away from the riffraff. And they looked at the Pharisees and the Sadducees and the Zealots and everybody else, and they said, my God, it's all riffraff, right? We can hardly stand to be in the presence of these filthy, stinking sinners. So what they did was they invented compounds, and they moved out to Wyoming. Right? They moved out of the middle of nowhere, and they mostly wouldn't even go into town to buy groceries. They tried to be as self-sufficient as they could, and the rule was you may not be an Essene, right? You can't just come and petition to be an Essene. There was some kind of process, but it was very difficult. The Essenes just wanted to be left alone and devote themselves to as much perfection in keeping of the law as they possibly could. And they thought if they were perfect enough, kind of the Pharisees thing again, but on steroids, if they were perfect enough in their little walled-off community, that God would save the Essenes. You're riffraff. They could care less about you. The Essenes went off by themselves because they believed once they hit perfection or some level of it or whatever, then God would come and save the Essenes and rid the world of all the trash, which means everybody else. Are you with me? Do you know an Essene? I meet them occasionally at church conferences and that kind of stuff. So they were bitterly divided. You have all kinds of people vying really for kind of different things. The Sadducees are just trying to hold on to power, and they don't like anybody. The Pharisees are just wounded and deeply broken, running around their whole life thinking, it's because of you. You should stop doing what you're doing and be more like me. And yet the Zealots, and nobody knew who they were for sure. And then you have the Essenes, and most people just, when they would come up, they'd say, no. So, pop quiz, which of those groups do you think John the Baptist came from? Am I the only one that ever heard this? Everybody thinks he's an Essene, because the Essenes were nuts, and they wore animal clothing, right? Think Flintstones, and they ate candied bugs and stuff like that. And what's the Bible tell us about John? He was kind of a nutty character too. So in seminary, they taught us, right? John was an Essene, and here are the characteristics of Essenes, and that's how you should view the things that he does and says. But now, because there's a lot of study that's happened in the last 30 years since I graduated, the biblical experts are saying, on second thought, truthfully, he couldn't have been an Essene because of the way he was. So Essenes stayed on their compound, and whatever happened there, but they were satisfied that they were the elect, the chosen, and everybody else was riffraff, and they didn't leave the compound. John the Baptist, when we find him in Scripture, where is he? He's not on the compound, right? He's out by a river, and he's talking not only to other Jewish people, he's talking to the Romans. So that is a very un-Essene thing. And when he invites people to repent, he throws it out there for everybody, and later we find out that he has conversation with Roman soldiers, right? So he's absolutely not on the scene. Here's my theory. I think, well, he's a prophet, and he was out wandering in the middle of nowhere, which is where prophets go, and he walked by an Essene compound, and he thought, wow, that is a great look, that whole animal skin thing. Think, right? And he noticed that they were eating candied bugs or whatever, and he picked that up too, because if you're a prophet, you don't have a lot of money. He was influenced by the Essenes, but he was an anti-Essene. The whole idea that his task was to go out and call the world to repentance was as far away from the Essene vision of what was going to play out in God's will and kingdom. They're just miles apart. So he was just an odd guy. But he couldn't possibly have been an Essene. Or he might have identified himself as an ex-Essene. Because even for them, right, he was odd. He was a strange man out doing a bizarre thing. But he wasn't a member of any of the groups that they divided themselves into. And that makes him really, really unique and special and wonderful. He was a man who, without a group to make him feel better about himself, dialed in and followed God. And that made him weird, but also compelling. I personally, I slayed him as a prophet. I think if you look back in the Old Testament at the great prophets, John lines up pretty well with them. None of those guys, a true prophet, they're an odd duck, because they're hearing stuff that the rest of us don't hear, and they're called to a very specific task, and that makes them unique and different. I'll step aside, because this is free advice from Pastor Steve. If you ever meet somebody who tells you they're a prophet, if you ever go to a church that the leader says he's a prophet, here are the things that you should look for. Prophets don't have any money. They don't drive big cars. They don't live in fine houses. They don't. Look in the Bible and find one that does, right? They're really odd, and they're off-putting, because they're absolutely deadly serious, and they don't yabber all the time about what God is saying. Most prophets dial in one message, and they repeat it over and over and over until you just want to strangle them in Christian love. Anybody else who says they're a prophet is looking for the power of the office and unwilling to pay the price of the prophet. Do you hear me clearly? Okay. All right, so John the Baptist was a prophet. an odd man. He was not any of the groups that I've talked about, though he may have been influenced by them. And in our story, as Christians, he plays the primary role at first. And here's what Scripture tells us about that. You'll recognize this part of Scripture, but I hope you listen to it with different ears, having kind of separated out the groups. This is John the Baptist in Mark 1, 1 through 8. Can we get it up on the screen? There we go. The beginning of the good news of Jesus Christ, the Son of God. As it is written in the prophet Isaiah, "See, I am sending my messenger ahead of you who will prepare your way." That's John's message. I'm here to prepare the way for the one that God is sending. "The voice of one crying out in the wilderness, 'Prepare the way of the Lord, make his paths straight.'" John the baptizer appeared in the wilderness proclaiming a baptism of repentance for the forgiveness of sins. Just let it sink in. That's what he proclaimed. You probably want to get yourself cleaned up because the one we've been waiting for is coming. That's his message. You should try your best to clean up the act a little bit before this guy that God sent gets here. "And the people from the whole Judean countryside and all the people of Jerusalem were going out to him, and they were baptized by him in the river Jordan, confessing their sins." That's crazy. If you knew that there was some yahoo in Tulare County out all by himself for proclaiming that what people really needed was to be baptized, would you run out there to get yourself baptized? No, you would not. It's outside, it's unsavory, it's not great. But what Scripture tells us is, my God, they were running out of the hills to hear John the Baptist. What does that tell you about the reality of Jesus' time? That at least they had the good sense to know, my God, we're in a lot of trouble. And they might have known that because when they looked around, all they found were groups saying, "We know the right way and you are the wrong way. Be like us or die." And it might be on the personal level, they just felt absolutely leaderless and rudderless, and they despaired for what was going to become their world. Tell me when I've stopped talking about Israel in Jesus' time and started talking about the present day. The reason they went out to see this kind of nutty screwball and listen to what he had to say was because they had heard all the other answers and they knew they weren't true. And they knew they were in trouble. That's why you would go to hear John the Baptist preach. Because deep in your heart, you would know, right, things are not right. Whether it's on the societal level or whether it's on the individual level, you know, I got to have some of what he's talking about, because he's at least talking about the possibility of a fresh start. That's the power and the appeal always of a call to repentance and to be baptized. So John was clothed with camel's hair and a leather belt around his waist, and he ate locusts and wild honey. And we've talked about that, right? Who wouldn't want to, really? He proclaimed, "The one who is more powerful than I is coming after me." Wow! What were the Pharisees saying? "Get in line, mister, you're the trouble." What were the Sadducees saying? "There is no line for the likes of you." What were the Essenes saying? "Line starts inside the compound and you don't have the password." What was John the Baptist saying? "Get in line because he's coming," right? And everybody's welcome, even if you're a Roman soldier. Anybody, everybody. He's here for the whole bunch. "The one who is more powerful than I is coming after me. I am not worthy to stoop down and untie the thong of his sandals. I have baptized you with water, but he will baptize you with the Holy Spirit." May the Lord add blessing to the reading of Scripture. I hope you join me in thinking, I really like kind of breaking it down that way and trying to contextually understand who was this guy that is so famous in the pages of the New Testament, and why was he the way he was? Well, he was a prophet, a true prophet of God, and really God only trusts him with very few messages. He got his message, his heart was stirred, he went out, and people could sense about him, if nothing else, that he was truly sincere, and he didn't think it was all their fault. He thought it was equally shared amongst everybody, and everyone had the same thing to do, which was get yourself ready because God has made the decision to send the one we've been waiting for. And that is attractive in some way, isn't it? If your whole life you've been hearing from other people and other groups, you're the problem, it's people like you, it's folks who think like you or do like you, right? You're the problem. If you'd straighten up and do what we think is best, and you'd be like us, and if everybody was like us, the whole world would be better and Jesus would come. That had to grow old on the common person's heart and soul. It grows old today, doesn't it? John the Baptist says, effectively, well, God has decided to fulfill his promise. Now's the time, right? And if you want to be the inheritor of what God has promised or what God's doing, you have to get real with yourself and you have to open yourself up. Effectively, in the language we use here in this church, it's a strange truth that you can only receive and activate as much grace and the power of God in your life as you are willing to dig a hole and make space for it, right? God loves you and his grace is for everybody and all that. That's absolutely true. But we move so easily into cheap grace, which is all you have to do is say, I accept your love and you're fine, when the gritty reality of following Christ is that if you're not confessing and repenting, if you're not looking at your own self and seeing what barriers you've erected to keep God at bay and to front yourself as your own king, then his grace is relatively inoperative. You have to make room, and you have to do it over and over and over again for the infilling of the Spirit. It isn't true that you just know a magic formula, say it, and then no matter how you live or no matter what you do, say, or think, or how you treat other people, it's all rosy. It's a much more complex thing than that. So the first thing that has to happen when the king comes is you got to get yourself ready, and that means you have to literally get rid of the poison inside to make room for the healing and the power that he brings. I'm not talking about works righteousness. I'm talking about an attitude before Almighty God. You have to be willing to effectively say, wow, right? There's a lot of stuff that I have done that is not in line with what you want, and I confess it and ask for forgiveness. And that forgiveness then brings the grace of God into your life, and things can start to generate, and your life can begin to change. It's much harder than Christians make it seem. It's easy to give a confession. It really is, and you have to confess Christ as Lord and decide to follow him. But after that, it's not magic. It's a gritty reality. You grow in grace in so much as you are willing to be honest about who and what you are. And when you spot something new, confess it, get rid of it, and make space for grace to deepen in your life. I think most of us would agree with what John the Baptist was doing because we're Christians, even in a divided world. I did a charge conference yesterday, which is hilarious. So I got to be district superintendent for a day. Who thinks that's a good idea? Me too, right? And I went, and nice people, we only had to take care of three items of business. That's all the conference would trust me with. And I was supposed to give a message beforehand. So here's the message I gave them. I know your church is struggling. Really, almost all churches are. It's a tough time in the modern world to be a Christian. And I also know that you actually think it is somebody else's fault. You think they're not singing the right songs, or you think the color's wrong in the sanctuary, or you think that you need a different pastor, or you think whatever, right? You all have all kinds of ideas about why things aren't the way they could be. And I just want to ask one question. And I ask them, raise your hand if you've invited anybody to church in the last 6 months. Why do you think nobody's going to that church? Could it really be the songs? Anytime we begin to look at life like it's everybody else's fault and they just do what I want them to do, everything would be fine. We are out of our minds. So as simply as I could and with as much grace as I could, I told them, here's the deal. You ought to stop looking around to figure out who is the problem and recognize it's you. And the problem is, you're not telling anybody about Jesus in any way, shape, or form. You're not even inviting him to your church so your pastor can do it. It's a long, hard process, isn't it? To stop thinking that the promises of God would come true and we'd have all that is promised if only other people would knock it off. If you believe that, other people have way too much power in your life. And you will be waiting for them to change to suit you until hell freezes over. Please listen carefully. What's wrong in your life is not someone else's fault, even if they sinned against you. It is the fact that you have not yet come fully into the presence of the living God with humility and confession and repentance and asked Him to change you. It's always the same way. And as long as God lets society go on and the second coming hasn't happened, we'll continue to divide ourselves into groups that think the problem is the other groups, and it'll never be true. So John the Baptist shows up and he has a really crazy idea. He says to the people, probably the problem is you, and you're probably going to want to take care of that because I don't know what this guy's like, but it could be big trouble. Can we get an amen? My own experience in life along those lines is probably very much like yours. Details might be different. I was born into the Southern Baptist Church. The title that they go by sometimes in the friendly confines of the Methodist Church, the Frozen Chosen. But I was a child and I didn't know anything that they believed. The only thing I ever heard in church was Jesus. And one day the pastor said, if you want to give your life to Jesus, right, you should know you're in a lot of trouble, and B, you should know if you come forward and give your life to Jesus, that trouble will change and God will bless you. And I knew for sure, without a shadow of a doubt, even though I was a child, man, I need that, right? Because everywhere I go, people told me, you are the problem. So I ran up there and gave my life to Jesus. And I was just a child. You might know, it never has mattered. That vow that I took that day counts for eternity. I gave myself over to Jesus. And that's why I am the perfect person that I am. And right, I really expected that, right? I thought I'd go up there and give my life to Jesus and I'll walk out of here and I will not be a bad boy anymore. That did not turn out to be true. It's a process. It takes a long, long time. I stayed in the Southern Baptist Church because they loved me and I loved Jesus, and that's all church was to me. And then in junior high, the prettiest girl that I could think of that would even talk to me invited me to church. Let that register. I am a United Methodist, and you're a leader now because some pretty girl invited me to church. That could be evangelism at its finest. I went to the Methodist Church. It was on the other side of town, the nice side of town. And I can remember, really, I can remember almost every detail about that day. I had never, ever in my life been to church and had fun. It was the sweetest, most joy-filled place I'd ever even thought about. Honestly, I was bewildered where you go, no one is crying, right? No one is gnashing their teeth. I don't even hate myself. This is weird, but I like it a lot. So I became a United Methodist. The little girl, for the record, had better taste in men than me, and she went off with somebody else. But I stayed. I was a Methodist longer than she was. I became a Methodist not because of the doctrine, not because I gave serious consideration to the theological underpinnings of the Wesleyan movement in the late Western societies. I became a Methodist because in the Methodist society, they were pretty serious about Jesus, but that seriousness meant that they expressed it in a joy and a sense of giving and an outreach kind of to the community that just wasn't present in the Southern Baptist Church that I went to. It's as simple as that. And then because I was serious about following Jesus, I decided to be a pastor. I heard it paid great, and everywhere you went, you got respect. So I went to seminary where I thought, listen to this. You probably think the same thing. I thought I'd go to seminary and they'd assign a spiritual guide to me, and that person would get to know me in depth, and they would teach me how to overcome the penchant for certain types of sin that I had that I couldn't defeat my own self, and they'd show me how to pray better, and they would craft and mold me until I was molded into the image of Christ, and then I would go out and I would be a blessing to everyone that I met on behalf of Jesus. And I thought there'd be, for the record, candles and incense too. No. No. Do you know what seminary is? It's corporate training. I was flabbergasted. Happily, I almost failed out the first year because I did not see it coming. It was like a change up pitch. They could care less what my relationship with Jesus was. That's true. No one ever asked in seminary. Never came up. They cared that I knew the right theology and that I understood why Methodist theology was superior to other theologies, pretty much all of them. though we go gentle on the whole telling people that. That's what they taught me to feel. And it was most important that I could wrestle theologically on a high and elevated level with fancy language and sentence constructs that would please the professors. And as long as I could do all those things, they could care less about my following Jesus. They also, really truthfully, they care less about the local church. When it was brought up in seminary, the local church was almost always spoken as something that was disdainful but necessary to support the hierarchy. I'm just telling you the truth. Here's the deal. I'm special in some ways. And I was special enough in seminary to recognize early on, wow, that is so wrong. None of this makes any sense to me. They're trying to turn me into an actual theologian. I'm not a theologian. I'm a follower of Jesus. So what I did was I wrote papers that they told me I had to write, and I said the stuff they told me I had to say, because you don't get the piece of paper that says you're a bona fide Jesus follower unless you do those things. But internally, as they lectured and told me about whatever it was, I just fought the battle. I just stuck as best I could to, that has nothing to do with, why don't they ever talk about the local church? Why don't they ever talk about how do you get better at following? Internally, seminary changed my life almost completely because it assured that I did not understand as a Christian that the most important part of my walk was having the right brand on the building. So I exited seminary knowing absolutely nothing about being a pastor, nothing at all, but being pretty sure I'd had a good lesson in what the church didn't need anymore. And in my own broken and stupid way, I set about trying to follow Jesus. And I adopted the common mindset for a very long time in my life. I think that the truth is my life has been full of people who are the problem. And if I withdraw far enough, they can't hurt me. So I had a little Essene in me. Or if I can beat them to the punch and shame and harm them, then they won't be able to hurt me anymore. And as soon as I get them all straightened out, now I'm Marshall Dillon. As soon as I get them all straightened out, then I will finally have the thing I've been chasing since I was 6 years old and answered an altar call. And I was as wrong all of my life as all the people that I have poked fun at today. Because the problem was never someone else. The problem was me. And the specific problem was I just could not for the life of me see that how I reacted to what people said or did to God was every bit as important as who might be right or wrong. Can you hear me? So in my life, John the Baptist never laid a glove on me until very late, and when he did, he knocked me out. I came to understand, oh my God, they're never going to change. So I guess I have to do it myself. And that's why I'm forming a new denomination, and I've got everything down exactly right, and if you'll just join and give me enough money, I'll tell you what is enough money, we'll be fine and go to heaven. No, you know that's not true, right? It's just the default of religious folk who lose the trail of Jesus. What I finally decided was, doggone it, I am sick of having people live inside of me who don't belong there. I'm sick of enhancing their, in my opinion, badness, right? By letting them live rent-free forever in my heart, in my soul, in my mind, and living my life trying to figure out what to do about them when I think that John was right. I just need to confess my own sins and stop it. And that's what I did. My sin was I refused to forgive anybody because forgiving, if you don't know, is a fool's business. It lets them get away with it. It encourages them to do it more. The only thing that happens when you forgive somebody else is peace begins to be a part of your life. In the Methodist Church, I suppose in the Southern Baptist Church, in the Catholic Church, whatever we finally hear the message, what you need to do if you want to walk with Jesus is confess your sin, don't worry about other people, and repent of your sin, meaning find a different way to live so you don't repeat the same mistakes over and over again. Until you hear that, the rest of it really means very little. Doesn't matter what team you play for, doesn't matter how right your leaders think they are, doesn't matter, none of that stuff matters. What matters is you got to get right with Jesus in your heart and in your soul, and you have to know why you need what he offers. And what he offers is forgiveness of sin, a cleansing, a digging out of trash so that you make room for his grace. And all of the rest of the stuff, as much as we like to fight about it and argue about it and carry on about it, it is not important. And it is not the fault of anyone else. Your salvation, your level of peace, your joy in serving Christ has only to do with your humility in confessing and repenting. I believe that to the core of my soul. We need to stop worrying about other people, other churches, other movements, and start worrying about first things first, which is we got to get right with God. So I have a big idea. I don't know how it will work. In the Southern Baptist Church where I came forward, it was great. They did an altar call every Sunday. Raise your hand if you've ever actually seen an altar call. They're a blast, aren't they? If you're a gossip and you don't know what's going on and somebody goes up, the preacher will blab about whatever it is they've confessed. Am I the only one? Really? Everybody knows that you're a sinner because you come forward. It just makes them feel so much better than you. But then after you confess and turn around, then you get to be. Anyway, I always liked altar calls a lot. But they're kind of abusive in truth. And they kind of put people on spot. And they're scary. And they present a huge challenge for people to actually do the thing, which is internally say, I want to give my life to you. Or sometimes, I want to renew my promise to you and begin the walk again. So we're going to do an altar call. But we're going to do the watered-down Methodist version of an altar call. Can I get an amen? So I had two alternatives at this point. One was I could ask God to give me special knowledge and I could go pick out the particularly bad sinners and pull you up here. And really, that would make history. That'd be memorable. They talk about it 30 years after I was dead, right? Do you remember the day? Yeah. But that just didn't seem to resonate in my prayer life. So I thought what I would do is I would speak the words that a person needs to speak if they're serious about the things we've talked about. Quit blaming other people. Quit thinking if you do that you're in the right movement and because you're Methodist you're going to go to heaven because you think the right things. Stop it. If it's time for you to stop it, if you recognize yourself in kind of the goofy way that I've put it today and you know what's lacking in your life is you really haven't come clean. You haven't really been honest with yourself and God about yourself, then today would be an opportunity for you. And the way we'll do it is I'll offer kind of a framework prayer, and I'll pray a little bit and stop and let you, if you want to, add stuff to it, which would be your personal junk, your personal whatever. You have a chance then today to kind of go back 2,000 years in history and in a way respond to the message that John the Baptist gave, which is it really is the truth that there's a great power in this world that can transform your experience of your life in every aspect, but you can't have it until you get serious about confessing who and what you are to God and asking Him to clean you up. You have to make room for the power of grace to really explore and expand in your life. So I'm going to give you that chance. If you're sitting there and you're thinking, I'm good. No. I'm fine. That's okay. Just be polite and quiet. If you're not a Christian and today is the day you want to become a Christian, this prayer will give you the framework to do that. And I would invite you, if that happens for you, to talk to me after service or call or email or text or Facebook, whatever it might be, I'd be happy to sit down and have a conversation about what you have started once you start to follow Jesus. More likely in this group, today might be a day when you begin to realize, yeah, that's right. Jesus is really powerful, but I'm blocked from it, and I'm blocked from it not because of what's happened to me or what other people have done, but because of me, and I need to straighten up. I need to change that. So I'm going to give you that chance. If you would bow your heads again, I'll pray a little bit and you add your part of the prayer as you will. So Jesus, I confess that I am incomplete right now. I have a lot of stuff, but I don't have peace. I have a storm brewing inside of me. I have anger and judgment, but I don't have what you promised. I know that I need to find a way to embrace the peace that you offer, even in the midst of the storms of my life and those storms still to come. So I confess what I know, and that is I've been trying to do it all by myself, and the path I've picked is a dead end. I thought I had the power within me to change my life, but I haven't been able to do it. I thought it was somebody else's doing. If they would just stop or go away, that it would happen, and it hasn't. I have lived my life in service of lies. I cannot make it past my own limitations. And I'm sorry that I refused to be honest with you before. I ask you today to help me. Forgive me for the things that I know about, and teach me the things that are blocking me from fullness with you, so that I might confess and repent of them also. I am ready today to begin to follow you. Help me be free from me, from the past. Help me to find joy and meaning. Help me to learn to love even my enemies. I do believe that your Spirit and your Son have given a power to everyone who asks, and I am asking for that power in my life today. I want to become what you made me to be, and that is your child, full of your grace, living the life that you choose. In the beautiful name of Jesus Christ, amen. With that on our hearts and our minds, let's stand up and sing the songs of faith. We'll start with Mary, Did You Know?
Did you know that your baby boy would one day walk on water? Mary, did you know that your baby boy would save our sons and daughters? Did you know that your baby boy has come to make you new? This child that you delivered will soon deliver you. Oh, Mary, did you know that your baby boy would give sight to the blind man? Mary, did you know your baby boy would calm a storm with his hand? Did you know that your baby boy has walked where angels trod? And when you kiss your little baby, you've kissed the face of God. the great I am. Yeah, yeah. Oh, Mary, did you know? Yeah. Oh, Mary, did you know?
Now we're going to sing Joy to the World to have a celebration. Joy to the world. We will sing, sing, sing. Joy to the world, the Savior reigns. Let men their song. Joy, repeat the sounding joy. God of glory, Lord.
sun above. Oh, joyful, 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 we adore thee, God of glory, Lord of love. Hearts unfold like flowers before thee, opening to the sun.
If during the prayer you made a confession to God and asked him to cleanse you of your sin and made a confession that you wanted a new start, the next step would be to join a grace group in our church. Grace groups are devoted to helping people have accountability for their walk with Christ and learning about grace as you go. It might also be, if it was a very, very hard thing for you and you realize today, boy, there's a lot of stuff I got to take care of. It could be that in the new year when we offer mending the soul, that that really is the place that you need to be to get the cleansing done and to get yourself started on a brand new path. So grace groups and mending the soul, you can call the office and find out about the dates of all of those and the places, or talk to any staff member. We certainly hope that today was a day when you made a decision to renew or for the first time to follow Christ. Will you join hands with one another now? Let's bow our heads and have a final word of prayer. Father, we've heard the news that your Son is the path of life. Help this church, help this denomination, help every individual in this place hear that message clearly and find the will and the courage to begin to follow him. It is in his beautiful name that we pray. Amen.